So, you've probably heard of the S&P 500, maybe even the ETF SPY, and perhaps even own a little bit of it. That's what everybody says to buy, and you know what? Hey, if everybody is cool with it, it should be cool with me, right? That's why in today's video, I intend to arm you with a little bit more knowledge so that as an investor, you walk in with your eyes open if you intend to invest in the S&P 500 or an ETF like the SPY. And of course, I'll end off with some alternatives for you to think about as well. Hey guys, it's Sunmin and welcome back to Your Money Game, the show where we'll save, invest, and feel better about money. Let me start with a quick introduction of what is this S&P 500 thing. I think it's safe to say that the S&P 500 is the world's most influential stock market index. Today, it's seen by many to represent how well is the US stock market doing. But also for many, it's a gauge of just how healthy or how well is the US economy doing. Its influence goes way beyond America though, because for the US, even though it is about 25% of the US GDP, or gross domestic product, the stock market alone represents about 56% of its total value. And this is why it's unsurprising that an ETF like SPY, which represents the S&P 500, is the world's largest ETF by far in terms of its assets under management, as well as the volume of it being traded on a daily basis. That's why America's influence and the S&P 500 in particular is so great in the world, and why investors like us, even all the way here in Singapore or Malaysia, we really just pay a lot of attention to it. Now for the rest of the video, I'm just going to call the SPY as a representative of the S&P 500 because it's just easier to say. The pros of the SPY are the easiest part of this video, so let me breeze through them. The first is what I mentioned earlier, which is that it represents the US markets. It's got a strong reputation, it's recognizable, and because of all that, it is seen as reliable and it's seen as a resilient index over the long term. The second pro is that if you are a long-term investor that happens to trust research data a lot, there are very few indexes that has the history and the length of data that the SPY has. And this is especially true for those of you who are paying attention to things like the FIRE movement, the 4% rule, and looking for a kind of passive investing way to get some reliable long-term returns. The third pro is that if you were into long-term investing, lowering your cost is one of those major considerations, and it's a huge pro for owning something like the SPY. Taking aside transaction costs, it is one of the cheapest things to own, which costs you roughly 0.09%. To give you an idea, it is simply $9 for every $10,000 you have invested on an annual basis. So that's really, really cheap. The final pro is that as an index, it is self-cleansing, which means that over time, the bad stuff gets tossed out and the best performing and the largest of US companies get captured in the index, and therefore as an investor, you get to benefit. Now, before I get into the cons and alternatives, if you're getting value out of this video so far, I'd appreciate your support by hitting that like button because it helps the gods of YouTube share this video out to more people. Thanks. Now, the cons aren't really cons per se, but they're simply imperfections that you as an investor should be aware about if you're considering investing in it. The first con is that it's a market cap weighted index, or market capitalization weighted. And it's related to what I mentioned earlier about this having an emphasis on the largest companies in the US. Now, this in itself isn't a bad thing, but if you are an investor, thinking about the US markets, we just have to remember that there are about 6,000 stocks there. So the top 500 aren't the only things in the US. Now, in your journey as an investor, you might actually learn to appreciate owning different types of indexes of the US. For example, you have something like the Russell 2000, which represents 2,000 of small caps, which are small capitalization stocks. And there are good reasons to own something like that depending on your investing style. The next con is that it is an index that's very concentrated, which unfortunately means that it's heavily influenced by a few names in the index itself. Now, despite being an index of 500 companies, the top 5 names account for 20% of the value of the entire index. And the top 10 names account for 30% of the value. Again, this is not an issue if you're aware of it and you're okay with it. But you should know that there are two camps that have very differing views on why this is a bad thing. One camp looks at it and says, hey, you've got too much concentration in these few names. Therefore, it's extremely risky if one of those names happens to mess up. For example, who knows, if you are Elon Musk and you're tweeting about selling 10% of your stake, maybe that has an outsized influence on an index. And then you have the other camp with investors such as Cathie Wood. And in her opinion, these 500 companies are holding a lot of what she terms as zombie companies, which is basically underperforming companies that are just held up by the power of those few names. So like I said, both those camps are coming at it from a different point of view, but both feel that it is a negative to use an index like the S&P 500. The final negative point is about its composition, which is very heavily skewed towards tech. About 35% of its weight is skewed towards it, and 8 out of 10 of the top 10 stocks are technically tech stocks. And this shouldn't be a shocker, because in the recent decades, tech has really done very well in the US, and it's just been on a constant rise, and a lot of it is due to how interest rates have been falling in the same way over the past couple of decades as well. However, there are those who believe that the super low interest rate environment we're in is not going to last forever, and we might just move out of it into a period of higher rates. And if that happens, it might influence the way you think about it when holding an index that is heavily weighted towards tech. Now, I did a video explaining a little bit more about the interest rates, so if you're interested in that, you can check it out. So those are the broad pros and cons, but let me leave you with a few other considerations if you're still somebody who's interested in the US markets but wants some additional ways of thinking about it. The first is that, say you are a believer in the whole index investing style, and again, you're interested in the US markets, and then you're thinking to yourself, hey, if I want to be more diversified, I can just buy the total US stock market through an index like the BTI, right? You might think that, hey, if it holds 3,800 stocks, it's more diversified and it should be safer, right? In theory, it's true, but when you look at the performance, it's actually very similar to the SPY, and it's because the top 10 stocks are actually really, really similar. Next is that, say you are a believer in the index's value, that it is 500 of the best and biggest companies, but you don't want the concentration. You actually do have an option by using an ETF called RSP, which is an equal weighted ETF. All the components of RSP are equally weighted in terms of percentage. Therefore, the top 10 names only represents 3% of the index's value. And that's a huge difference versus the 30% of an index like SPY. The final consideration is for those of you who want broader diversification but still feel that the US is a priority. You can always invest in a ETF like VT, which is the total world stock market. The majority of its composition is still allocated towards the US at about 60%, but enjoy diversification across major regions around the world. If you wanted to make sure that you are more protected and diversified, that's an option for you to consider. So thanks for watching, guys. If you got value out of this, I'd appreciate your support in clicking that like, sub, and bell button. And I'll be back again next Sunday with a brand new video. Until then, you take care and keep playing your own game.